introduce our speaker today. Most of you are already familiar with him, and for no other reason than he is the co-instructor for this course. Dr. Greg Carr is an associate professor of Africana Studies and chair of African-American Studies at Howard University and an adjunct faculty member at the Howard School of Law. He holds a Ph.D. in African-American Studies from Temple University and a Juris Doctor from The Ohio State University. Since y'all wrote me, I must say, undergraduate degree is from Tennessee State University.
That's what I'm talking about.
What?
I got a cheer for that. Cheer for that.
The school district filled out his first president Salvador on race and culture. Dr. Carr led a team of academics and educators in the design of the curriculum framework for Philadelphia's mandatory high school African-American history course. He is the co-founder of the Philadelphia Freedom Schools Movement, a community-based academic initiative that has involved over 13,000 elementary, high school, and college students. His publications have appeared, among other places, in the African-American Studies Reader, Socialism and Democracy, Africana Studies, Publications of the Modern Language Association of America, the National Urban League's State of Black America, and the Malcolm X Historical Reader. He is also a co-editor of the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations Multi-Volume African World History Project. Dr. Carr is the first vice president of the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations and a former member of the board of the National Council for Black Studies. He's been named Professor of the Year 3 times by the Howard University Student Association, the College of Arts and Sciences Student Council, and the College of Arts and Sciences Honors Association. He was also named Male Professor of the Year at the 4th Annual HBCU Awards at the 2014 HBCU Media Week held in New Orleans, Louisiana. And again, this isn't just at the college level, this is with all HBCU professors. He has represented Howard as a spokesman in a wide range of print and electronic media, including the New York Times, the Washington Post, Le Monde, USA Today, MSNBC, National Public Radio, BBC America, C-SPAN, and I could go on, but he asked for a short introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm, precious summer, welcome, Dr. Greg Carr.
We're gonna do something we've never done before, or at least try to. These embodies every week are very important. As Dr. Williams told you, the presenters, the lecturers, read your embodies. I'm going to be paying particularly close attention to these over the next 30 days because I want you all to help me do something that involves last night and tonight. Last night, they didn't know. Tonight, to this morning, you know. This afternoon, you know. This is a picture taken of Howard students at a place called Apet Issut, which is considered the most selective places, one of the earliest learning centers in world history. It's on the banks, by the banks of the Nile, in a place the Greeks called Luxor. I want y'all to help me write an article. I'm gonna read these 1,000 embodies, and the quotes and the comments that you all make, I'm gonna select out of them. I'm gonna put them in an article. Those of you who were on campus Friday and who filled the second floor of the Howard Bookstore, Barnes & Noble's at Howard Bookstore, to capacity to hear one of the world's great living writers, Ishmael Reed, talk about his book on Muhammad Ali and the last 3 generations of African-American history in this country. Probably remember that toward the end of his remarks, as he was going through question and answer and began to discuss, he talked about the fact it was very difficult for people to teach and write at the same time. He's a professor, he was at Cal Berkeley for 25 years, and he talked about that. That's particularly hard for people at historically black colleges who teach. And I don't talk about people who teach a couple classes, but whose primary work is their research. I mean folks who spend most of their time teaching like we do. So I thought about that, and I said, you know, I'm gonna write. This is something that I wrote after we left. And then the next day, when some of you all went down to see Claudia Rankine, the author of one of our texts, sits at the National Book Festival. I wrote this, and I said, you know, there are things you cannot fake, like buying and reading books. When a long line of students snaked out the door in front of Ishmael Reed last Friday at the Howard University Barnes & Noble, books in hand, hope erupted. Reed had tried to share a photo from a page in my copy of this book with the audience, and I had stopped him. Perhaps it was my highly functioning autism, triggered at the thought that many other people were touching a book of mine. But I remarked, no, I don't play that. That's my copy. You have money for food, you have money for books. That repurposing of the famous dicta of Erasmus, you know, it was Erasmus that said, when I have a little money, I spend it on books. If I have any left, I buy food. It's kind of a joke, but it makes the point. But the repurposing of that famous dicta of Erasmus was, of course, fortuitous to the moment. It wasn't lost on me at that moment as well that tuition and cost at Howard is over $40,000 a year, that the university distributes over $80 million in forms of financial aid per year, actually over 100 this year, 100 million, that there are many students who are unable to come or to remain at Howard due to debt and no financial ability. And that, at that very moment, a student-led social media campaign named #TakeBackHU had captured the country's attention as a testament to the collision of the corporate university model with the ideals of higher education among Africans in the United States. And yet, students lined up moments later to buy a book unrelated to class from one of the world's great living authors. We saw some of those same students the next day at the Library of Congress National Book Festival, standing in line to have their copies of Claudia Rankine's Citizen autographed after listening to her remarks. Thomas Jefferson's private collection, of course, is the seed of the Library of Congress's corpus. Jefferson died in debt, and the bodies of many of the Africans he enslaved were sold to satisfy that debt, including some of his children. Jefferson's life reminds us that there are more powerful factors than debt in modern society, that whiteness has served as a perpetual debit in the ledger of human potential and resource, with indebtedness of anti-blackness serving as a perpetual shackle on those same resources. That some of y'all were Claudia Rankine the next day at the Library of Congress. This is one of the world's great scholars on Thomas Jefferson and the leading authority in the world on the relationship he had with enslaved African Sally Hemings and the children they had together. That's Sister Annette Gordon Reed, who's told an audience of close to 1,000 people that day. I was sitting way up front. Can't see all the way in the back. She said she's gonna write an article about all the people who have been trying to stop, to obscure the fact that Thomas Jefferson fathered children with this African woman, which means, of course, that he sold some of his own kids, and after he died, he was broke, and they sold them. This is the book that can help you read more about that. That's Henry Weedneck, who was a Wingset, Master of the Mountain, Thomas Jefferson and slaves. Y'all want to read more about it. But what we're going to do today, it's a little different. You know, there are a lot of people around the country writing about black colleges. They call them minority-serving institutions, MSIs. This is one of the country's quote-unquote leading scholars on it, Mary Beth Gaston at the University of Pennsylvania, which last I checked was a historically white college or university, HWCU. But they have a Center for the Study of Minority-Serving Institutions. And of course, we're only a minority in this in the context of the United States. The world looks a lot more like the beautiful tapestry of individuals collectively convened here in Crampton this afternoon, than it does at the University of Pennsylvania. But they want to be experts. Educating a diverse nation, whatever. I'm all about that intellectual warfare. We're talking more about war in a minute. To the right, you see an article that was in the Sunday Washington Post before YouTube and online classes that were the great courses, where people now are saying, well, you can just learn online. And this company, the great courses, some of y'all probably heard of it, they pay superstar professors to go and take lectures. That's a guy from Georgetown giving a talk. And then they sell it to people all over the world. Who knows? Maybe the idea is one day you'll never have to come to universities, except that's not the case. There will be certain universities in the world, Berlin, Oxford, Cambridge, Harvard, Stanford, Chicago, where you will always have to come because the people who convene are the ones who expect to run the world. Everybody else can go to DeVry or watch Steve Harvey on commercials talking about go get your degree in your spare time. These individuals are on the steps of the Carnegie Building. Yes, the one that you all have been trying to wrestle with to get all y'all schedules straight over the last 3 weeks. These individuals came here to create something called the Encyclopedia of the Negro. This was 8 decades ago. Some of them, I won't name them all, but you see W.E. Du Bois sitting there. Du Bois always took those pictures where everybody looking at the camera. Du Bois looked to the side like, y'all gonna look at me even in this camera. Benjamin Brawley from Atlanta University. Next to him, Charles Wesley with his hat in his hand. Very good friends with Carter Woodson. Next to him, you have Monroe Nathan Work from Tuskegee and Otilia Cromwell from Massachusetts. All the way over in the right, you see the little cat with his hand in his pocket. That, of course, is Elaine Locke behind him, Mordecai Wyatt Johnson. The great Afro-Puerto Rican, Arturo Schomburg, up by the window with the part in his head. These Negroes came and said, we must now rewrite the history of the world. And we'll meet Howard. He never wrote that encyclopedia because the funding dried up. But I want y'all to help me do something and tell my friend Ishmael Reed that after you left here, I worked for a month on an article. It might even end up being a book. And the thousand students of co-ops helped me write. And you'll see some of them quoted in here from the Imani forms they fill out. Because we're about to flip the whole scripture here. We are not about to go out like this futuristic, silly corporate model of education that is somehow got our children thinking crazy, right? So let's talk about that. What about slavery and aftermath? Let's talk about that. You know, it was global in scope. Enslavement touched every continent. It built the modern world. It was asymmetrical in tactic. Some people were enslaved in their very homes, like the Aboriginal people of the Western Hemisphere. Some got rolled on, and in fact, the word slave is not one that comes out of Africa or Asia, it comes out of Europe. It was used to the whites who were enslaved, the Slavs. That's where the word slave comes from. It was asymmetrical in tactic. It was multivalenced in effect. When you take that many people off a continent, you inhibit its development. People say, what's wrong with Africa? Well, we can start with you took millions of people out of there over hundreds of years. Let's slow down and think. Conventional warfare, war was never declared on Africa. Not formally, not a declaration of war. And there was no formal declaration. There was no truce negotiated. When did the war stop? I'd argue the war continues. See, Freddie Gray's family settled for $6.4 million yesterday. They're having a press conference while we're in here. They started at noon. But you know what? You can't bring him back. I'm like Mike Brown's mom. Justice will be my son alive, and that ain't gonna happen. I know Sabrina Fulton, mother of Trayvon Martin. What a beautiful, beautiful woman she is. What a powerful spirit. She said, that changed my life forever, but I'm not gonna go into my sorrow and stay there. I'm gonna use it. And she's got a band of mothers that travels the globe around us, you know, but there was no peace officially declared. The reasons for the war did shift, however. There were economic reasons. We don't need them anymore to work like this. We can just free them. That way we ain't got to house them and feed them. And then we can just make them wage slaves. That's what we are now. It was political. We want to keep the country together. That was Abraham Lincoln's rationale. And it was cultural. Cultural, meaning what? Enslavement of your body is one thing. Enslavement of your mind continues. Our minds continue. And we're still in what Ira Berlin has called the long emancipation. A new book that he wrote. He gave that talk at Harvard. I like to buy these books when they give these talks at Harvard and turn them into books, but we're about to flip the script. We're going to produce some books out of these conversations at Howard. I want y'all to write. And I'm going to write. And we're going to write. We're going to change the whole conversation. This is Jacob Carruthers from Texas, one of my great master teachers. He made the transition about a decade ago. Why we must discuss learning wisdom and the African experience. What he said over the arc of the time I knew him is going to shape what we talk about today. You know, Jack Carruthers said the most serious threat to African dignity is in the domain of intellectual ability. How we think, how we move through the world. You know, he also said African champions must break the chain that links African ideas to European ideas and speak to their ancestors without interpreters. That doesn't mean we don't read non-Africans. That means that we read everybody, but we have to talk to our ancestors too. Right now, we're not talking to our ancestors, and they're screaming like, hey, we were here for a long time. Here's something we thought we understood. Everything's focused in the future now. The future's going to be great. What about all the futures that people had that developed stuff that they gave to us? Okay, so I guess then we can forget these computers. Why? This is the past. We didn't invent this. What is the relationship between learning and wisdom, insight? What are the contributions to contemporary learning of ideas and practices derived from Africana? This is the lesson of Jacob Hudson Carruthers, who when he died, had taken on an Egyptian name, a Kemetic name, in addition to the name his mama gave him. Jedi Shimshu Jehudi. The one who listens is a follower of Jehudi. Jehudi is the Kemetic symbol along with Sechet of writing and counting, a classical African concept. There's a picture, a portrait rather, a painting from Carrie James Marshall, born in Birmingham, raised in LA, lives in Chicago, won the MacArthur Genius Grant. A beautiful brother, the first African person to have his work exhibited at the top of the National Art Gallery. And all the black guards who work in the Smithsonian, some of them wouldn't even take breaks. I was down there talking to the Carrie James Marshall, the last day of his residency there over several months, and all the security guards came down to wish him and his wife goodbye. Brought him pound cake and banana bread, and everybody else in the Smithsonian was looking like, who are these people? Carrie James Marshall, these are my people. You know who these people are. He's loved all over the world, but he, you know what? He don't even paint white people. That's the color of every black subject in all of his paintings, hung all over the world. That's one that hangs right now in the National Portrait Gallery. I saw some Howard students down there on Monday. I was down there writing, and I saw him come in. I said, that's a beautiful thing to see y'all down there, right by Chinatown. Some of y'all know where the gallery is, right? This is his painting, SOB. She's got a whole wall of books on the African, on African history and culture back there. If you look closer, you can see the titles. And she's sitting there, and the thought bubble is, SOB, SOB. Is she sobbing, or is she saying, son of a bitch? I read these books, and I'm like, there's a reason why Carrie James Marshall is one of the world's great artists, and it's a reason why he said, as you all appreciate me, you only appreciate me because I appreciate my people, and when you see me, you see them. Why do we study this black stuff? When do we stop talking about race? What does studying the past have to do with me, with society, with the future? Are black people genetically or culturally inferior, family? Is there evidence of black greatness? Are you just making this stuff up? Well, let's see what Dr. Du Bois would say. He's an honorary degree there at the University of Ghana, where he spent the last 3 years of his life. Du Bois said, you know what I've been fighting for and am still fighting for is the possibility of black folk and their cultural patterns existing in the United States and America without discrimination and on terms of equality. But what does he say? What we must do is accomplish two things. Number one, the utter elimination of color discrimination in American life. That's what we've obsessed with. And number two, most importantly, the preservation of African history and culture is a valuable contribution to modern civilization as it was to medieval and ancient civilization. What good does it be to be alive and walking around if your people are not contributing to the forward flow of human progress? Dr. King understood that. There he is when he's closer to y'all's age, not even out of his 20s yet. Broke the back of the Montgomery bus system with those Africans down there like E.E. Nixon, Rosa Parks, and Joanne Robinson, and that whole crew. There you stand in front of the bus. Dr. Du Bois, you know, said one thing. Here's what Martin King said in his 20s. He said, you know, if you will protest courageously and yet with dignity and appreciate love when the history books are written in future generations, the historians will have to pause and say, there lived a great people of black people who injected new meaning and dignity into the veins of civilization. Now, we know I have a dream, part of the speech. We know where the rock is that everybody goes down and sees the statue of Martin King. But how much have we read of Dr. King, the words he left us? What did King say about Du Bois? You know, he said Dr. Du Bois was not only an intellectual giant exploring the frontiers of knowledge, he was in the first place a teacher. He would have wanted his life to teach us something about our tasks of emancipation. He said that in a speech honoring Dr. Du Bois. What does it mean to be a citizen? That's what Claudia Rankine is asking. Ta-Nehisi Coates asks the question, how do I live free in this black body? If you have to ask the question, you're not free, brother. How do I live free? You think everybody in the world asks that question? How do I live free? No. We saw something last night that's only rare because they don't put tennis rackets in the hands of black girls and boys. Two sisters playing for the way on the way to a championship, right? People stop what they was doing to watch that like it's a spectacle. Okay, what happens when you put tennis rackets in a lot more black people's hands? Then you might have to stop to watch two white women play. But the spectacle still remains because it's still so rare. But you think about that. What is the relationship of human memory to identity and recovery? What is the relational dynamic of becoming? We know history is memory. It's what we remember. But it isn't just that. How you write history is then how you preserve it. That's what they call historiography, the writing of history. That means the inscription of memory and vision, setting it down so you can read it, so that somebody is writing not just for today, but for generations from now. But you have to read first. And then historicity. Once you have that, you have a concept of yourself in time and space. I'm sure everybody in here has been in a situation when you learn something and then you all of a sudden saw yourself very different. When y'all go home in November for break, or when you go home over the semester, at the end of the semester for break, you're going to look at the world very differently than you did when you came here in August. You're already starting to look differently. learning every day about yourself. That's historicity, seeing oneself in time and space. What happens to groups too? This is a book by David Christian, The Fleeting World, A Short History of Humanity. He asked some social studies teachers to tell him, you know, what do you know about American history? And they started talking about the Revolutionary War and the Civil War, World War I and World War II, and they started naming presidents, and they started talking about the Gilded Age, and they started talking about the Korean War, and they started talking about Vietnam and Richard Nixon, and okay, very good. Well, tell me something about Western civilization. And they started talking about the Holy Roman Empire and Charlemagne. Someone was real smart, right? So they started talking about the invasion of Gaul by France, and by the Franks. They said, oh, yeah, that's nice, and the Norman Conquest in 1066. Okay, very good. Tell me about world history. And they said, okay, well, we could go on. We could talk about World War I in Europe. No. He said, no. Tell me about world history other than Europe. Well, China. He said, what about China? It's there. Okay, you don't really know any Chinese history. It's too many people. Okay, great. India. He is there. Okay. And there were Indians. There were a lot of people here before Columbus found Columbus. Okay, great. Now, tell me about African history. Yeah. Martin Luther King? Well, technically, yeah. Barack Obama. In other words, you see then how history is. How can you see yourself in time and place and you don't even know anything about the people who've been in time and place? Of course we come in begging. That's why we wrote the World History Project. Dr. Mario Beatty and I, the co-editors of that project, the Association of the Study of Classical African Civilizations Preliminary Challenge. We got to set the world right side up. That Africa you see back there in the design looks like it's upside down until you stop and think that a map is a square. The world is a ball. Which way is up in space? Even a map is a political document. You turn it this way, it might as well be the same as turning it this way. Except when you turn it this way, you can talk about sub-Saharan Africa, third world, whatever. And if you look at the earliest maps that the people of Kemet wrote, they went the other way. Modern awareness of African thinking traditions. There's a book called Global Intellectual History. You gotta look. Piss poor chapter on Africa. They don't know much about African intellectual history, so they don't write much about it. There's a book called The Book, A Global History. Got both these books. I bought that book. The chapter on the book in Africa starts basically with the arrival of non-Africans, as if there weren't any writing systems. They've never heard of this book. Clear. The Abamba Benga, African Philosophy, the Pharaonic Period, 2780 to 330 BC. We'll come back to that in a minute. I'm going to quote something that's written in there. Classes of knowledge, the hierarchy of thinking and people. Let's think about that. You know, there are people who say the modern university comes out of the church. That's very true. The rituals, all this kind of stuff. Even the separation of the learned from the not learned. You know, there are many societies, and Du Bois talks about this elsewhere, where everyone must learn because everybody contributes to the society. And there are other societies that say we got higher education for the people who are going to manage the rest of y'all. It ain't for everybody. They even got us saying that. Dual college ain't for everybody. Is learning for everybody? Yeah. Okay, how you differentiate from learning in college? Hadn't thought about that. Okay, fine. When you think about it, let's continue this conversation. In fact, let's bring in the Ivy League, Harvard and Yale and Penn and Brown and all those schools, Columbia and King's College in New York. Many of those schools got their money out of the bodies of enslaved Africans, their labor. There's a whole book Brother Craig Stephen Wilder at Massachusetts Institute of Technology wrote a couple years ago called Ebony and Ivory, Race, Slavery, and the Troubled Histories of America's Universities. Y'all can go to Princeton for graduate school, and when you get there, remind them that it used to be when the Southerners would send their children to that particular school, they had rooms set aside at Princeton so they could bring their enslaved Africans with them because they needed services. When Sonia Sotomayor busted up in there in the 1970s, they were still segregating by gender. Michelle Obama wrote her thesis, her undergraduate thesis at Princeton on race. It's worth a read. That's why that sister ain't never been unclear about where she lives. Howard University. What's the difference between Howard and those other schools? Absolutely nothing in terms of structure. And everything in terms of the people who populate it. We talked about that last week. Equal justice, equal rights for all at Howard. The search for truth, training new generations, how to produce new knowledge. Well, how do we reframe our framework in 40 minutes? Less than 40 now. We got the Mbonge. That's what we're working on, right? That's what y'all writing on now. We ask different questions. We begin to find different answers. We tried to start this Mbonge process at Philadelphia Freedom Schools, about 15 years ago. Dr. Yeboah, Amy Yeboah, ran Freedom Schools for several years in Philadelphia before she joined us here on the faculty at Howard. We created a whole curriculum. There's Sachette, the sister in the leopard skin dress. She's the companion to Jehudi. She invented everything that can be counted and measured, from astronomy to architecture. That's their symbol in ancient Egypt. So I'm talking about who can't do math, created it. Lessons in Africana Studies. We then said we're going to build a curriculum for the first mandatory African-American history course in a major school district in this country. We wrote the curriculum for that. Dr. Bailey, Dr. Watkins, and African Studies here at Howard helped us do that. And then we put it together, published it as a book, and then said, you never see little black boys associated with learning. So we want a little black boy on the cover. You know what? Put him on there 12 times. You gonna look at this child. That's your responsibility. And then, of course, we work here in Africana Studies, and we have freshman seminar. We about learning, about that learning life. So is African progress fantasy? Remember I asked, is there any evidence? Well, you know, I read comic books. Today is comic book day, too. At some point, I got to sneak out between now and the class I teach at the law school and get my comic books. Those of you who read Marvel know they all in the whole thing. They destroyed the Marvel universes now. They're going off into this battle world thing. Dr. Doom is God. Oh my God, it's crazy. But it's Afrofuturism with the Black Panther. Afrofuturism is when you're looking forward, but you're drawing on the past and imagining a future. Y'all heard of George Clinton, maybe Sun Ra, maybe Michelle and Dave Ocello. I mean, they're looking forward, Nalo Hopkins and some of these people right here. You know, that science fiction is a fascinating thing. And I know many of y'all have read Octavia Butler. She's writing about the past, but she's projecting it into the future, which relieves people of that guilt. It's a nice move. This is the Black Panther who's from Wakanda. Wakanda is an imaginary African country, but the question is asked in Wakanda is, what would have happened if this African country had never been invaded, no enslavement, no colonialism, and just gone on and developed the same way other countries developed? So the Panther don't mess with Europe. He talks to them like human beings. So here he is at a meeting in Switzerland, and the European diplomat wants his stuff, like they want stuff from Africa. They wanted people, came back, wanted gold and iron, manganese, copper, rubber. They wanted the coltan that makes all these cell phones and laptops work. So here he comes, he wanted to negotiate. So the Englishman says, Your Majesty, we pay whatever price you set for your goods. We'll give you money. My man, the Panther, the T'Challa said, they are not supposed to. He said, until the central advancement of the West catches up to their technological prowess, it would be irresponsible to share our scientific discoveries with you. Science is one thing. That's why you need the humanities. Remember what Claudia Rankine said on Saturday? That's why you need arts and sciences. Some people are really silly. They talk about STEM, man. No, no, that's vocational education. Did you know any history of American education? Are you just talking? Just talking. So the man now is upset. But you don't want the money? He said, what? Are you calling everyone here irresponsible children? My man's cold, he's like, no. More like sullen teenagers who feel more mature than their behavior warrants. The fact that every conversation here is framed in terms of profit and power says it all. And they start telling you, get education so you can make money and be powerful. Them is the people you probably need to say, slow your roll, chief. Is that really what it's about? For that, I could have just kept my radio on and asked my parents what they thought. And said, for our generation, it was first you get the power, money, then you get the power, then you get the motherfucking respect. And I can't even imagine how many young people that took out the libraries and sent to the streets to hustle. This is Black Panther fighting Captain America. He met him in World War II, you know what I'm saying? My man's like, he came to spy. Wole Soyinka, the great Yoruba writer, friends with Ishmael Reed, came to Howard a couple years ago. We read of Africa as one of the books for our freshman seminar. He said, there also exist dynamic perceptions, ways of perceiving, responding, adapting, or simply doing that vary from people to people, including the structure of human relationships. These all constitute potential commodities of exchange. Not as negotiable as timber, petroleum, or uranium, perhaps, but nonetheless recognizable as defining the human worth of any people. And could actually contribute to the resolution of the existential dilemma of distant communities, or indeed to global survival, if only they were known about or permitted their proper valuation. It's one thing to pay for gas or living. It's another thing to have knowledge. That's a dynamic possession. It's another thing to have culture. That's a dynamic possession. It's another thing to be able to move in a space where people say, that culture transformed the way I look at the world. When y'all swag surf, as I was told last night, Dr. Myers told me that's what y'all call it, right? It may seem like a small thing, but there are people who look at that and say, do they all know each other? Where did they learn that? That's culture. and then the next thing they do is, oh, how do I do it? In other words, there are dynamic possessions, things you do that change the way people view the world. You turn a company that made boots for hiking into a $1 billion business just because you put the shoes on your feet. That's culture. Very important. Style, We're talking about those. Now, y'all know what this is. This is a map of the so-called trade and enslaved Africans. What we really know is the declaration of war against African peoples that is ongoing. Many people in the middle of Africa, towards the lower part, West Central Africa, that big arrow goes to what country over in the Western Hemisphere? Brazil, right. Spent some time in Bahia, and they study this. They don't study North American history, they study the history of Africans in Latin America. Went down there, was fascinated, had a conversation with 400 school teachers about this, African school teachers. But I want to talk about a word that comes out of West Central Africa, a word that Robert Harris Thompson introduces. This is a guy at Yale University who talks about this notion of imbongi, a house without rooms, a place where privacy has no room. We're going to read what y'all wrote, y'all going to help, we're going to write this article, right? But his teacher was from there. He wrote a book called Aesthetic of the Cool, some of his speeches, this is the last thing that he's published. But his teacher, Kimwandinde Kia Bunseki Fukia. Professor Fukiao, who became an ancestor a couple of years ago. Dr. Fukiao is an expert from Congo, and he wrote a book called Mbongi, an African traditional political formation institution. In other words, when you come together, you solve problems. We're going to talk about that a little bit. Let's see oneself in time and space, the beginning of wisdom. That's Roland Alcindor. He just wrote a book called Yoruba Art and Language. He talks about something called the Oriki. An Oriki is your testament, is your story. Every time you write something, every time you sing something or create something, you're creating for the future. It's going to outlast you. What will your grandchildren think we were thinking about when they go through the archives and find empire and power? I don't know. None of us can know. But the question you have to ask yourself is, what are you producing so that when your great-grandchildren come around, they can look at it and say, this was the Oriki. This is heroic. This is what I will draw on. Because guess what? Empire and power, not new. They had those kind of things going in the 1920s, 1820s, 1720s, all of that. You know, that's how it works. It's human. But what do you leave for eternity? That's a young sister right there from Howard at a place called Abu Simbel, looking at Ramesses II presenting truth, justice, reciprocity, ma'at to his wife, Nefertari, an African love story. She fell in love on that same trip. She and her husband both met Howard, took them to the Nile Valley. They fell in love over there. Just got married last month, poor libation at their wedding. But they over there looking at this wall. Black love. Cookie ain't mad. You give it to the bit. Anyway. Let's combine. We're in the Mbongi. Four quick turns. I got my eye on the clock. Four quick terms as we move forward. We need to know these four terms as we go forward. They are related to Mbongi. They speak to what happens in the Mbongi. The first, we're going to repeat after me. The first is Boko. Boko. One more time. Boko. Boko, that's right. Boko means to break or to cut, as in the deciding of solutions and problems. Some of y'all been in those conversations that last all night, y'all arguing with each other, working out with each other. That's a Boko. You're breaking something down to solve a problem. The next one we're going to do is Yimba.
Yimba.
Yimba. Again, Yimba.
Yimba.
Nice. To create a shelter in order to cover and protect. We come here for 50 minutes once a week. When we're in here, it's like the rest of the world doesn't exist. I don't know what future generations will do because we're tethered to these electronic devices. It is difficult to turn off electronic devices. There are probably one or two people right now who are glancing down at them and then coming back up as if you can keep up. But this is not. This is an Mbongi, meaning what? You got to be present. It's not as easy as, oh, what? Well, I missed it. Of course you did, because you're not in the conversation. I don't know what these eighth graders are going to do, or these third graders. God bless their souls. Some of y'all are going to be school teachers. And you know how hard it is to get somebody to put their eye on a book right now. Can you imagine what's going to happen when you have to face in 20 years somebody who's like, why we got to read? Meanwhile, the people who run the world never stop reading. Next of the three to four, Luzanga. Luzanga.
Luzanga.
Luzanga. To mix. To put together. To assemble. Somebody can't dance, you stay on the outside. When the big song comes on, you dance on the outside, you can learn, and then you come in. Because we're mixing. We're assembling. We're putting together. That's what swag surfing is, right? Everybody the same. Somebody going this way, where everybody going that way, you done messed it up. This is Luzanga. And you know, if you've ever been in that space, even looking at it, it's like, that just looks like something I want to be in, right? You're mixing it. It sends energy. Y'all been to a sporting event where they do the wave? That's cool. But my God, when we go in the stadium, watch this, mark my words. In the next hour long, you're going to see somebody at an event swag surfing, and it's going to be about 5 black people in the audience, 60,000 people. What happened? those dynamic possessions. Y'all got us all doing this now. But by then, you may have gone on and invented something else, because that's the genius of creativity. You build on the culture, you extend the culture, but you gotta have something to build on and extend. Finally, we go with this last one, Kyoto.
Kyoto.
Kyoto. To inhale, as in to intake a healing property or a cure. I like to think of that as the fixed vapor rub element of embalmment. Some of y'all have had them rough hands that elders put that fixed vapor rub all up in your chest and under your nose and all in your hair. Like, but what are you doing? I'm helping you, I'm opening you up. And then they put their hands on you and pray. What you doing? I'm inhaling this into you. I'm a plant. And everybody come to you like, and now all of a sudden you some kind of way you feel a little better. Like I asked them last night, some of y'all gonna find out how country some of your classmates are when you find out there's a few Negroes in here who probably have had to eat fixed vapor rub. Any of y'all need that? Look at that. See? They're like, oh, yeah, that's the beauty of going to school. You can't get that online. You talk to each other. You exchange culture. You deal with your elder. You did that in ancient Egypt. You did that in Timbuktu. Timbuktu is where they had the books of Timbuktu, the manuscripts. All right, y'all. This is a picture of an Mbangi in Elephantine Island in Aswan in Egypt. The young Nubian sisters, most of those girls now are approaching teenage age if they aren't already teenagers. Every time we go, those Africans meet us at the boat with jump ropes, and the sisters get off the boat and they're like, okay, you dudes, we ain't got no use for y'all. Y'all can take pictures, but y'all, let's see what y'all got. Like, whoa, this is serious business. These are some 8-9-year-old girls with jump ropes talking about, they go to Howard people, get off the boat, let's go. Get the circle. And we bring them, you know, writing instruments and things like that. We bring them stuff, but they're like, we want to see our sisters. That's what that is about. So, you know, I'm going to save distance at the balcony in one of the buildings taking a picture, but I'm going to get out of this conversation. It's not for me. Juhal, I'm at that circle every August, no question. You know, there it is right there. The burning of fears, right? Men getting in a circle, write down the thing that scares the hell out of them, put it in the fire. Reconstruction. One teacher for a whole lot of people. A lot more people than in this room. Gotta learn how to read. 4 people know how to read. Your job is to make sure by the time we get out here in a couple of months, everybody can read a little bit. So as you teach somebody, they teach somebody, they teach somebody. That's an embalming. This is a picture that was on the front page of the New York Times a few years ago from South Africa. These young people right here studying for their matrix. The sister in the middle looking over at the sister on y'all's left. The one on the left looking at the sister across the table like, you better not get this wrong. Not because I'm mad at you, because this is our future depends on this. Any of y'all ever been from any of these places where education is so important and so valuable? People fighting to get where we are. And then they come over here and say, I thought y'all was more serious about studying. Why y'all going out again? Okay. This is a bunch of Howard students in Kemet a few years ago. I just wanted to show y'all this because I love Michael Jackson for a number of reasons. But one of the things is, even if he did nothing but remember the time. Y'all see that picture when he was kissing Iman, right? And he looks out over the pyramids, like, that looked like a fantasy. It wasn't a fantasy, that was real in terms of what it looked like at that period. And believe me, the people in that video look a whole lot closer to the people who were there than the people in some of these crazy things like Exodus with Batman. That's a joke. But you got people, here's the problem, there are 2 problems. The minor problem is there are people who believe that's what the people look like. But the major problem is there are people who will say, who cares? The who cares thing is the thing that makes your mental slavery real, as Robert Nestor Marley says. Ramesses II, they have his saku, the so-called mummy. Check out the joke, said his hairstyle looked like that cat to the right. So I ain't mad at Michael Jackson and Iman. I'm not even mad at Eddie Murphy because he looked pretty much like Ramses II. So you could play that cat. Experience, learning, and wisdom. Let's make the distinction between experience, learning, and wisdom. Here's Black Lives Matter folks disrupting holiday shopping. That's important. It's very important, but let's be very clear. Disruption can be revolutionary. Remember, that's what Claudia Rankine said Saturday. She says, revolutionary disruption. We're forcing you to acknowledge our presence, that we're there. We're not going to let you carry on with business as usual. But that's not, but simple resistance in itself is not excellence. It's not in itself excellence. I resist it. That's not excellence. It's an important thing, but it's not excellence. Experience can inspire. And learning is necessary for wisdom. But neither in itself is wisdom. We all need master teachers. Here we are in Kenya, right? That's my mother right here looking up as the light shines down. I took her over there for her 80th birthday, right? That young sister right there with a hand on her chin, and she poured a graduate from Howard twice. Undergraduate degree, then got a law degree. She's now an attorney in Minneapolis. She learned the metanetra after looking there. She said, I need somebody to teach me. That's not the way it's with the camera up. She got her hair straightened there, but you know, the whole metamorphosis thing going on. But you see her with the camera, right? Take this picture right here. My mother's a dyed-in-the-wool Christian, born on the floor in Alabama 87 years ago last week. But you know what? She looked at those pictures and said, you know what? That doesn't disrupt my understanding of Christianity. It enhances it. Now I see its origins. We all have to become as master listeners. Instructions link generations. This is actually Seti the First with his son. They're looking at all the pharaohs of Egypt. You want to grow up to be a ruler, you got to look at the rest of these rulers. You don't just show up and say, I'm running things. What about all the people before you? Did you learn anything? No, I'm just going to push this button. That's the Urkel model of leadership. Ooh, did I do that? Right. Dwight Keddie, the satire of trade. That's what he says. You know, he said, writing is the best of the professions in that. This is a brand new book called The House of 20,000 Books. Sasha Abramson. Her grandfather grew up in a house where it was 6,000 books in the house. And it was a place where people met and read and discussed and talked and shaped what she thought. You know, the search for good speeches or better than that, or writings, that's what the Egyptians would call writings, good speeches. That's the foundation of intergenerational education. Let's end with you boys. I'm going to wind to a close here. His books, I stacked a few up last year at my house, took a picture of them. That's not all of them. Most of my books are in storage. 650 boxes of books in store, but I got another several thousand at the house. If y'all came here to get education, don't you think your faculty should be well prepared to help you? That's my job, to make sure the future is secure. Your job is to make sure the future is secure. Both our jobs is to go back into those good speeches and find the thing that will help us make sure the future is secure. It's our job. It's what our people sent us here for. There's young boys, closer to y'all age. See his wave cap off for the picture, it's very nice. He was born in Great Barrington, Massachusetts, 1868. He went to Fisk as an undergrad, then got another degree and a PhD from Harvard. In 1897, he gave a talk here in D.C. called The Conservation of Races. He said, every group of people got something to contribute to humanity. He was professor at Atlanta University. This is where he was on the steps of that, actually a little bit late. You know, he was there at Atlanta University when he came here to Howard to do the Encyclopedia of the Negro. He attended the first Pan-African Congress where he's bringing the Africans together from around the world. He co-founded the Niagara Movement with a bunch of other Africans trying to stop what was going on in this country against black people, co-founded the NAACP, went to a number of other Pan-African Congresses, moved to Ghana to work on that Encyclopedia Africana years after he stood on the steps here at Howard and passed away over there in Ghana where he is buried with his wife. I visited his grave with people. We stand there. It's a very powerful thing. He said, I'm an African. I'm in the world. I will not separate myself from any human being based on where I came out of my mother's womb. I belong to the world. There he is with his grandson, great-grandson, Arthur McFarland, still alive, good brother out in Colorado. Met him several times, good cat. He gave a speech to his grandson at a party in Atlanta. He said, you take this, and his grandson now, years after Du Bois died, still has that message resonating as he goes forward. Let's talk a little bit about this. This is the credo. Du Bois wrote this in 1938. It appeared in a book he wrote called Dark Water, but it also was published in other publications. In other words, we're going to leave with this. This is what Du Bois believed. He said, this is my statement of belief after living in this world for 6 decades. He lived another 30 years. Du Bois said, I believe in God, who made of one blood all nations on earth to dwell. I believe that all men, black, brown, and white, all women, black, brown, and white, are brothers, varying in time and opportunity, in form and gift and feature, but offering in no differing in no essential particular, and alike in soul and the possibility of infinite development. That's like pictures of black people in the community. Prince Hall Masons, sisters in Salvador, Bahia, doing the festival of the Bois Morte, the good death. The sisters in the middle, the Carolina sisters in the rain shop. Sister Corn Libation, very simple thing. West Africa, going through the investiture. Especially do I believe in the Negro race, in the beauty of its genius, the sweetness of its soul, and its strength in that meekness which shall yet inherit this turbulent earth. It's that swag, it's that black coolness. He said, I believe in the Negro race. I believe in Harriet Tubman, who died of old age because they couldn't catch her up and down the Eastern Shore. 300 people free, dozens of trips. Perhaps the first woman to direct U.S. troops in military affairs, that she told them where to go and burn plantations. We couldn't catch you. $50,000 price on her head in the 1850s, calling her the general. Why not? She said, because I ran these backwoods with my father and his friends for years. You got a map. Wisdom. It's different than learning and experience. We could talk about Nina Simone all day. I believe in pride of race and lineage and self, and pride of self so deep as to scorn injustice to other selves. Black lives matter. In pride of lineage so great as to despise no man's father. In pride of race so chivalrous as neither to offer basket into the weak, nor beg wedlock of the strong, knowing that men may be brothers in Christ even though they be not brothers in law. I just put some couples up there. Malcolm and Betty Shabazz, Du Bois, W.E.B. Du Bois, and Shirley Graham Du Bois, Essie Robeson and her husband Paul, of course, Amy Shot Garvey, her husband Marcus Garvey, Winnie and Nelson, of course, and Louis Armstrong, the great Louis Armstrong and Louise, playing their horn in the shadow of the Sphinx. I believe in service, humble, reverent service, from the blacking of boots to the wiping of souls, for work is heaven, idleness hell, and wage is the well done of the master who summoned all of them that labor in a heavy labor. Making no distinction between the black sweating hot hands of Georgia and the first families of Virginia, since all distinctions not based on deed is devilish and not done. The word in ancient Egyptian for love is mer, M-E-R. But you have to see the glyph. Y'all can take power of this here, Howard. We worked hard to get the best scholars on this faculty. You'll see the picture is a picture of a backhoe, the same thing you use to break the ground to plant. Farmers use it. For the Africans, to love is to work. To work for something, for someone. Somebody can tell you what they want out their mouth. It's what they do that shows you how they feel about you. I believe in the devil and his angels, who wantonly work to narrow the opportunity of struggling human beings, especially if they be black, who spit in the faces of the fallen, strike when they cannot strike again, believe the worst and work to prove it, hating the image which their master stands on a brother's soul. Du Bois said, I believe in the Prince of Peace. I believe that war is murder. I believe that armies and navies are at bottom the tinsel and braggadocio of oppression and wrong. And I believe that the wicked conquest of weaker and darker nations by nations whiter and stronger temporarily, but foreshadows the death of that strength. You want to know what's wrong with America? Go back to the founding of the project. You want to know why things are coming apart in Europe? Go back to imperialism. You want to go to the whole crisis, the nuclear crisis in the world? Why are we worried about nuclear weapons? Because a culture took over this world for several centuries that said, my job is to kill you. That's not science. That's philosophy. That's not learning. That's lack of wisdom. I believe in liberty for all men, the space to stretch their arms and souls, the right to breathe and right to vote, the freedom to choose their friends, enjoy the sunshine, ride on the railroads, uncursed by color, thinking, dreaming, working as they will in a kingdom of beauty and love. Got two more slides. I know it's 12:59, but let's just stay close because I want y'all's embodiment. I'm going to work on this thing over the next month. I'm going to report to you. I believe in the training of children, black even as white, the leading out of little souls to the green pastures and beside the still waters, not for self nor peace, but for life lit by some large vision of beauty and goodness and truth, lest we forget. And the sons of the fathers, like Esau, for mere meat, barter their birthright in a mighty nation. Y'all protect this institution, because the next generation has to be here. Finally, he says, I believe in patience. Patience. Patience with the weakness of the weak and the strength of the strong, the prejudice of the ignorance of the blind, patience with the tardy triumph of joy and the mad chastening of sorrow, patience with God. That is Du Bois with his wife, Nina, and the little boy they lost because he died in Atlanta. Couldn't get good health care in segregated Atlanta. That's his mother with him. You never know what your child gonna grow up to be. I know some of y'all's parents right now, family, are like, I never knew y'all would do that. Oh, I'm sorry, I got one more, because we went to the New York African Burial Ground, right? Yes, indeed, we are. That's us pumping our fists about 2 years ago. And on that, I'm gonna leave you with the quote. That is the last quote. That is the last slide. That is a quote from ancient Egypt. That is a quote from 3,500 years ago. Cherish study. Avoid the dance so that you'll become an excellent official. Write diligently by day, recite at night. Let your friends be the papyrus roll and the scribal palette. Such work is sweeter than wine. as from the royal scribe, with session at suit. Neb ma'ari not to describe one ni di e moon. 20 comedic dynasty. Y'all can read the bills for yourself once you take it here, Howard. Thank you all for staying over.